I'd like to introduce with great pride for such a great advocate, Yali Lincroft.
Thank you, Lori. It's truly an honor to be here today. I represent First Focus Campaign for Children. We're a bipartisan national organization housed in Washington, D.C., and we're dedicated to making children and families a priority in state and federal policy decisions. It's appropriate that we're having this event right next door to the Children's Center over there. And as we watch the children enjoy their childhood like all kids do, let's just remember that. These are our children. So my presentation will focus on the current national landscape. Each year, as we're now in January, brings us hope for policy reform and changes. And realistically, policy reform in 2012 will probably not be with the 112th Congress, which is generally considered one of the least productive Congress in 60 years. Rather, reforms and changes in 2012 will most likely be happening with all of you, the children's advocate and the policy champions, happening at the state legislation level. So throughout the country, there's really been draconian cuts in all social services for all kids and programs. For example, I'm from California, even though my agency's in DC, and we recently have seen child welfare agencies cut their staffing anywhere by 20 to 40%. And our governor has recently proposed a $1 billion cut to safety net programs like TANF, child care subsidies, mental health. These are dark days indeed for all vulnerable families, U.S. citizens, immigrants. And the conversation at the state and federal levels is all about jobs, it's all about the economy. So, what are we talking about here in this climate in this state? After your state, Arizona, enacted your SB 1070 legislation and controversial Show Your Papers bill, conventional wisdom would have it that other states would be lining up to copy this destructive, enforcement-only approach to immigration. And there has been some prominent copycat bills. We've seen them in states like Alabama, Georgia, South Carolina, and recently Missouri, which has just introduced legislation attacking the educational rights of children. However, the vast majority of states have rejected similar bills, and this widespread rejection has been largely due in no small part to the efforts of the business community. They are acutely aware of the deep economic pain and social upheaval that has accompanied the passage of SB 1070, and all of you know it, all of you are living it here. So it's not good for business, it's not good for kids, and these punitive state measures are also been largely defeated because of you, the intensive advocacy on the part of faith-based community and children's agencies. So to all of you who have worked hard on these campaigns, I applaud and I commend you, and I want to say these campaigns work. They make a difference. Over the last 2 years, the states have increasingly turned toward common sense legislation that welcomes economic contributions of and the taxes paid by our immigrants and non-immigrant communities. One of the chief ways, and I'm hoping this is a sort of a positive light on light of sort of all the negative things we're talking about here, but one of the positive ways we've seen this is the advancing of tuition equity measures, some known as DREAM Act at the federal level, but also what you guys are doing on the local level, some plus and some not. So already enacted in 14 states, we have tuition equity measures which allow our talented, undocumented young students to attend state universities like this at the same rate as their U.S. citizen legal or permanent resident classmates. They're on the agenda again in 2012 for states like Colorado, Hawaii, and New Mexico. So if we really do care about jobs, if we really want to get out of this economic situation, these tuition equity bills are telling us forward-thinking approach to immigration, ones that focuses on helping nurturing young talented youth and putting our tax dollars to better use than destroying families. So if I have a theme to my presentation today, it would be this: saving lives and saving money. When it's heartbreaking to hear the stories that Seth and others are hearing day to day about families, you should also think about the financial motivation why states should not separate families. It's expensive. The foster care system is expensive. It has both immediate and long-term consequences. Immediate costs are court costs, costs money. Every time someone, a child enters the system, you have to have an attorney assigned to the state, the parent, the child. There's administrative costs, there's emergency health placement, there's foster care placement. The dollars add up very quickly. And sadly, there's long-term costs. We've shown studies over and over again, the increased likelihood of children in the foster care system have a higher rate of accessing services like special education, juvenile justice, mental health need. In fact, a recent GAO report documented the increased use of psychotropic drugs on children in the foster care. Of course, these costs are justifiable when there is clearly a best interest of the child having the child removed for child welfare. But are these the kids? Are these the families, really? So throughout the child welfare system, there's just not enough interpreters, translation services, bilingual, bicultural staff. It's a very difficult system for anybody to understand, even if you're a US citizen. So you can imagine if you don't speak the language of the culture. And we see the severe shortage of staff and budgets and social services everywhere, but I think it's particularly acute in the immigrant cases. So given our gap, our budget shortfalls, when our communities are struggling to preserve core services like education, fire protection, park services, is this really the best way you want to spend your money, separating families? I want to share some federal legislative solutions, which my Client First Focus campaign for children have been advocating. There's handouts on the table, one of which is the Help Separated for Children bill that is sponsored by Senator Al Franken and Representative Lynn Woozy, which seeks to protect children and families during the immigration process, including that children who enter the foster care system are able to reunify whenever possible with their detained and deported parents. The bill also allows for a release of designated vulnerable individuals. It limits the presence and involvement of children in enforcement activities and ensures that family members are able to locate them when they're detained. One of the saddest things we heard yesterday when we were at the detention facility was one of the mothers that was telling us that the social worker was using the child as a translator in the case. For those of you who are involved with the child welfare system, this breaks confidentiality, best practices in so many ways that I don't even want to start. But we're hearing about this happening over and over again. One of the things I want to note, it's important to note that the provision of the health bill, and in fact many of our recommendations, can be adopted immediately by the administration. It doesn't take a change in law, just leadership and willpower. So I also encourage all of you, as you look at the materials there, many of these changes can be adopted by your state administratively through local laws. But again, leadership, it's not a cost of money, it's a cost of willpower. I commend the Obama administration, which recently has introduced some promising reforms. In 2011, there was a memo from John Morton about prosecutorial discretion. That is a critical consideration in the right direction. So the memo specifically said that recognized the importance of considering whether an individual is a parent of a US citizen child and using that discretion to allow that parent not to be detained. More recently, the administration proposed a regulatory fix to the immigration process that would protect many families from the pain and hardship of being separated by years. So currently, an undocumented immigrant must apply for and receive legal visa from their country of origin to rejoin a spouse and child in the US. That can often mean they have to wait in their country for years and years. The Obama administration is now proposing regulations that allow them to stay in the US. We commend all these things. However, we encourage the administration to move forward now, immediately, because our families are waiting while these processes are taking a long time. The bottom line is this, we need more than proposals from the administration and the state. We need action and we need change immediately. Thank you again for allowing me this time.